Hello, and welcome to Ask the Nutritionist, the Zakim Center for Integrative Therapies and Healthy Living's monthly nutrition webinar. My name is Christina, and I'm the nutrition coordinator here at the Zakim Center. And I'm happy to speak with you all today about our February 2024 topic, Nutrition for Heart Health. We chose this topic for February as it is Heart Health Month, and we know that certain cancer treatments can weaken our hearts and therefore increase our risk for cardiovascular disease. Not all treatment will affect our heart health, and the risk of developing cardiovascular disease depends on a number of factors, such as how healthy our hearts are, the drugs we're receiving, as well as the dose of these drugs. However, whether your treatment impacts your heart disease risk or not, a heart-healthy diet provides many benefits and follows the general principles that would be recommended for reducing cancer risk. Let's get started with our agenda. Today, we will first be discussing lifestyle factors that promote heart health, including physical activity guidelines. We'll then focus on the cardiac diet, looking at what it is, what to choose, and what to limit to support heart health. And finally, I will reference some heart-healthy recipe libraries for your review and inspiration. Again, we'll start today with the fact that healthy lifestyles promote heart health. Specifically, making healthy lifestyle choices can help lower our cardiovascular disease risk, also known as CVD risk. One piece of a healthy lifestyle that promotes heart health is adequate sleep. The American Academy of Sleep Medicine recommends 7 to 9 hours a night for most adults. If you're experiencing difficulty sleeping or getting quality sleep, I would recommend checking out our sleep and relaxation toolkit on my Zakim for tips to support your sleep. Additionally, managing stress is another lifestyle factor that can help to support our hearts. Our sleep and relaxation toolkit may also help with stress management, and I would also reference our 8-week mind-body resilience course to support stress management if you are looking for assistance with that. And you can access these programs and registrations on my Zakim. Maintaining a healthy weight is another aspect of a healthy lifestyle that supports heart health. Regularly exercising is also going to promote heart health. And finally, following a balanced diet, which we will delve further into with our presentation today. Before we review physical activity guidelines, I want to acknowledge that you may not be able to meet these goals right now, and that is completely fine. If you are new to exercise, are experiencing limitations due to your treatment, or perhaps are managing fatigue, I would encourage you to check out the resources we have on our MyZakim website, such as our fatigue toolkit and both live and on-demand chair exercise classes that focus on stretching and strengthening to build your activity in a safe way. The physical activity guidelines for Americans do recommend 150 minutes of moderately intense aerobic activity per week, or 75 minutes of vigorous activity per week. Moderate to high intensity muscle strengthening activity is also recommended at least twice a week. We also want to spend less time sitting, and we'll gain even more benefits if over time we're able to increase our activity to at least 300 minutes per week. That being said, we want to increase the amount and intensity gradually over time, starting where you are now, and any movement is going to benefit your health. I wanted to just give a bit more information on these terms and what they mean. So, as far as moderately intense exercise goes, this is a type of exercise where we'll notice our heart is beating faster and we're breathing harder than normal, but we can still talk. It's considered medium or moderate effort. Some examples of moderately intense exercise would be brisk walking, ideally at least 2.5 miles per hour. But again, start with where you are, and any movement, any walking is great. Water aerobics, dancing, gardening, tennis and biking less than 10 miles per hour would be considered moderately intense exercise. Now, vigorously intense exercise, on the other hand, requires a higher amount of effort than moderately intense exercise. It will likely cause us to feel warm and sweat. It's unlikely that we'll be able to talk without getting out of breath while participating in vigorously intense exercise. Some examples of these exercises could be hiking uphill or with a backpack, running, swimming laps, doing heavy yard work, playing tennis, singles specifically, cycling 10 miles per hour or faster, as well as jumping rope. If you have questions about physical activity, or where to begin or what is safe for you to do at this time, I'd highly recommend utilizing our wonderful exercise physiologist and gaining her expertise. Nancy Campbell is our resident exercise expert at the Zakim Center, and she does offer free one-on-one virtual exercise consults. If this is something you're interested in, please give us a call at the Zakim Center or send us an email, and we'd be happy to coordinate that. Now that we've covered physical activity recommendations for heart health, we'll move on to our key topic for today, which is nutrition for heart health. I wanted to begin with a cardiac diet. What does this mean? Well, it's an unofficial term for a heart-healthy diet. It encourages limiting foods that increase our risk for cardiovascular disease. These would include processed foods high in sugar, salt, and unhealthy fats. And it also emphasizes foods that promote heart health, like vegetables, fruits, whole grains, lean poultry, and oily fish. When it comes to oily fish, some examples of these would be salmon and tuna, which are rich in omega-3 fatty acids. There isn't one specific cardiac diet or heart-healthy diet, but some examples would be the Mediterranean diet, DASH, which stands for Dietary Approaches to Stop Hypertension, as well as many vegetarian diets. All of these recommendations and guidelines for these styles of eating are very similar to the recommendations to reduce cancer risk as well. So, beginning with what is recommended to limit in regards to promoting heart health, we're going to start with the American Heart Association, or AHA's, sugar guidelines. Their guidelines refer specifically to added sugar. We do not need to worry about natural sugar found in whole foods, nor the lactose, which is milk sugar, in dairy. Now, the average American adult consumes about 17 teaspoons of added sugar per day. What's recommended by the AHA for men is actually no more than 9 teaspoons or 36 grams a day. And for women, no more than 6 teaspoons or 25 grams a day. Just as an example to reference these numbers by, one 12-ounce can of soda contains about 8 teaspoons or 32 grams of added sugar. And when it comes to identifying added sugar sources in our diet, now if you're looking at the nutrition fact label, added sugars will actually be listed specifically under the total sugars. So you're able to identify what is the number of grams of sugar being added. The less added sugar we can have in our diet, the more we can reserve it for special occasions, the more that will promote our heart health. Next, I wanted to review the AHA fat guidelines. So there are four major types of fat: saturated fat, trans fat, polyunsaturated fat, and monounsaturated fat. The AHA guidelines recommend limiting the bad or unhealthy fats, which would be saturated and trans fat. We'll start with a little bit of information on saturated fat. Saturated fats tend to be solid at room temperature. They elevate our bad or unhealthy cholesterol, which is our LDL cholesterol. And the AHA recommends limiting saturated fat to 5 to 6% of your calories per day. Now, what does that mean? Well, for the average 2000 calorie diet, that's going to be about 13 grams of saturated fat. That is what we'd want to stay within for the day. And you can, again, look at a nutrition fact label and see specifically the number of grams of saturated fat in the food, the packaged food that you are choosing. Sources of saturated fat would include beef, lamb, pork, the skin of poultry, cream, butter, cheese, ice cream, and tropical oils such as coconut and palm oil. Trans fat not only elevates our unhealthy LDL cholesterol, it also unfortunately lowers our good HDL cholesterol. Sources may include fried foods like donuts, baked goods, cakes, pie crusts, biscuits, frozen pizza, cookies, crackers, and stick margarine. And I say may include because these foods do not inherently have trans fat, but you can look at the nutrition facts to see first if there's any trans fat. And you can also look at the ingredients list to confirm that there's no trans fat. And the reason we need to do both of these things is because if a food contains zero to some amount greater than zero to 0.5 grams of trans fat, you can actually say that there's 0 grams of trans fat. But if we look at the ingredient list and we see partially hydrogenated oils listed, that actually means that there is some trans fat, albeit a small amount, but there is still some present in that food. So if you see 0 grams trans fat, that's a great first area to focus on and the nutrition facts. But then I'd recommend looking at the ingredients to confirm that there is no partially hydrogenated oils. Saturated fat, we want to limit. Trans fat, we really want to avoid. Next, wanted to review the American Heart Association's salt guidelines. So the AHA recommends no more than 2,300 milligrams of sodium per day, ideally moving towards no more than 1,500 milligrams per day, if possible. Too much sodium increases our risk for elevated blood pressure, which increases our risk for heart attack, stroke, and heart failure. When it comes to reducing salt in the diet, I wanted to review a few tips so that we can maybe put this into practice. So we want to choose packaged foods carefully, comparing the nutrition facts to find foods with less sodium. We want to pick fresh and frozen poultry without added sodium, looking out for terms like broth, saline, or sodium solution, which can indicate that there is additional sodium in that food. We also just want to be mindful for anyone who is, again, watching sodium, if you perhaps have high blood pressure, that prepared rotisserie chicken can have about 400 milligrams of sodium per serving. That being said, if you do not have high blood pressure, I think rotisserie chicken can be a really convenient way to get some lean protein in, especially if we're removing the skin, which is where the saturated fat is. We want to watch for added sodium in condiments such as soy sauce, bottled salad dressings, ketchup, salsa, pickles, mustard, relish. We want to look for canned vegetables and legumes with no salt added, if possible. But if we do not see any with that claim, we can rinse and drain the brine from these canned foods to help lower that sodium content. We also want to choose frozen vegetables without salty sauces. And we do want to skip the table salt, or at least reduce it. And that is because just 1 teaspoon of table salt contains 2,300 milligrams of sodium. So that is our maximum amount of sodium that we want to stay with under for the day that we're having just in that 1 teaspoon. We also want to cook at home whenever possible because we have so much more control over the sodium that is added, the salt that is added, and save eating out and takeout for special occasions. I also just wanted to note that sea salt, unfortunately, does not contain any less sodium than table salt does. Now, how can we reduce our salt but still enjoy our food? This is a common question that I receive and I completely understand. I'd recommend choosing flavorful ingredients such as garlic, herbs, spices, citrus juices, and vinegars. Try combining lower sodium foods with regular versions of the food as a starting point. Additionally, grilling, braising, roasting, searing, or sauteing can increase flavor while cooking. And I will just add that though over time, this can be a level of salt that we get adjusted to. If we make changes to slowly decrease our salt intake, our tastes and preferences for foods can change. So foods that were once just the right amount of salty for us can over time become too salty if we're decreasing our salt and sodium intake. So though this may be challenging initially, just know over time our body does adjust, similar to how it does with sugar. So it does get easier over time as we slowly decrease the amount of salt and sugar in our diet. Our body over time prefers and gets accustomed to those lower levels of salt and sugar. And now that we've reviewed the guidelines for salt, sugar, and fat, I wanted to review foods to choose more often and foods to limit within the different food groups to support heart health. We'll start with grains. And within the grains, whenever possible, we want to choose 100% or whole grains to ensure that we're getting, again, the entire whole grain and the fiber and vitamins and minerals that are in the entire grain that are lost during that refining process, which results in white grains. Examples could be whole grain bread, bagels, English muffins or tortillas, brown rice, wild rice, quinoa, oats, farro, barley, whole wheat or whole grain pasta or couscous. And with these recommendations, we want to have whole grains whenever possible, but the general rule of thumb is having half of our grains be whole grains. So if you're choosing whole grains half the time, you're gaining the nutritional benefits and the fiber that support our heart health. Within the grains, we want to limit baked goods like cakes, cookies, muffins, scones, biscuits, white rice, bread, and pasta. Having these no more than half the time, as well as snacks containing partially hydrogenated oils. These may include crackers, microwave popcorn, but again, not all crackers or popcorn are going to contain trans fat. We can look again at the label and we can look at the ingredients for partially hydrogenated oils to see if the food contains it or not. And again, when it comes to fiber, whole grains are really going to pack a significant amount, and this helps to lower our LDL cholesterol and lower our cardiovascular disease risk. For women, it's recommended to have at least 25 grams of fiber per day. For men, at least 38 grams per day. That being said, if you're not having high fiber foods in your diet already, such as whole grains, fruits, vegetables, or aren't having them in large quantities, I'd encourage you to slowly increase these foods so that it does not cause any GI, gastrointestinal distress or discomfort. Next, we have a protein. Within the protein group, we want to choose seafood, especially varieties rich in omega-3 fatty acids like salmon, mackerel, herring, tuna, trout, poultry, chicken, or turkey breast without the skin, or at least 93% lean, ground turkey, or chicken. We want to choose lean meats. These would include pork shoulder, beef sirloin, or at least 93% lean ground beef. Plant-based proteins are great options like beans, peas, lentils. We'll talk a little bit more about eggs, but eggs can fit in as well. Also, unsalted seeds and nuts. And finally, tofu. Within the protein group, we want to limit high fat cuts of beef, like ground beef, ribs, T-bone, ribeye steaks, processed meats like hot dogs, sausage, salami, lunch meat, bacon, organ meats like liver, brains, and fried fish, or chicken, as well as poultry with the skin. The skin is where we have most of the saturated fat that is going to be in poultry. So by removing the skin, we're able to decrease the saturated fat we're intaking. So what about eggs? Well, you may have heard over time, eggs have had a good reputation, then a bad reputation. So I just wanted to clear the air on the recommendation on eggs. And provide a little background on this. So eggs are high in dietary cholesterol, about 200 milligrams per egg. And there was a recommendation to not have more than 300 milligrams of cholesterol in the day. So that would be difficult to stay within having more than one egg. When it comes to foods that are high in dietary cholesterol, they tend to also be high in saturated fat. Eggs and shellfish, like shrimp and lobster, are actually exceptions to this rule. So, eggs are high in dietary cholesterol, but they're not also high in saturated fat. Saturated fat is what is definitively linked to elevating our bad LDL cholesterol. The evidence is less conclusive on the impact of dietary cholesterol on our LDL cholesterol levels in our blood. The 2019 American Heart Association Science Advisory notes that healthy people can include up to one whole egg or up to two for older adults per day. For those with high LDL cholesterol, it is limited to recommend both saturated fat and dietary cholesterol to be cautious. So, with eggs, I recommend for those who have high LDL cholesterol to limit egg yolks to no more than four per week. But you can assess that and discuss that further with your doctor or a dietitian. I just wanted to note too, as we age, our risk for high LDL cholesterol does increase as well. So, in conclusion, when it comes to eggs, if your LDL cholesterol is elevated, I would recommend having no more than four yolks per week. But if you don't have high LDL cholesterol, again, you can have for older adults up to two eggs per day, for younger adults up to one whole egg per day. When it comes to vegetables and fruits, we want to choose fresh vegetables and leafy greens. Canned vegetables are fine to include, but we want to rinse the vegetables to remove salt. And if possible, choose canned vegetables that are no salt added. When it comes to frozen vegetables, we want to choose frozen vegetables without added butter or sauces. All fresh fruits are great to incorporate. When it comes to canned, frozen, or dried fruit, that also works well to support our heart health, but we want to look for varieties that do not have added sugar. We want to limit fried vegetables and fruits, vegetables prepared with butter, cheese, or creamy sauces, canned or frozen vegetables, and heavy syrup as well. So, again, when it comes to frozen or canned fruits, ideally we're looking for canned in its own juice or water, and no additional sugar or syrup added to any sort of frozen fruits as well. As far as dairy goes, we want to choose fat-free or low-fat options, such as skim or low-fat 1% milk, fat-free or low-fat yogurt. And I just wanted to note for anyone who's looking to increase protein, Greek and Icelandic yogurt will be even higher in protein than traditional. And with all yogurt, we want to limit added sugars, which again will be separated on the nutrition fact label from the natural sugars. Fat-free or low-fat cottage cheese can be a great option as well. I would recommend looking for no salt added whenever possible, as cottage cheese is traditionally very high in sodium. Fat-free or low-fat ricotta would be another choice that could support your heart health and be in alignment with these goals. We want to limit full-fat cheese, cream cheese, whole or 2% milk, whole milk yogurt, ice cream, and cream or half and half. And again, with all of these slides, as far as limiting goes, we are not saying you need to exclude it beyond the trans fats, just thinking that we want to reserve those foods for special occasions or every once in a while if we do enjoy them. Next, we'll review fats and oils. We want to choose unsaturated vegetable oils like olive, canola, safflower, peanut, soybean, sunflower, and avocado, to name some. And we want to limit butter, stick margarine, shortening, tropical oils like coconut palm and palm kernel oil. Now that we've reviewed foods to choose and limit within the different food groups, as well as fats and oils, I wanted to mention another tool that may be available to you to help when you're in the grocery store to select foods that are going to support heart health. And this is the American Heart Association's Heart Check. It's another tool that can be used to quickly determine if a food may meet AHA guidelines. How it works is that a company must get approved by the AHA to participate in this program. So what that means is that not every program, or not, excuse me, not every food item that would meet these guidelines has this heart check because a company must apply to receive it. And products submitted are reviewed for the heart check certification requirements. And the product package and promotions are also reviewed by the AHA. Certification renewal is required to maintain the heart check as well. And with the heart check food certification requirements, these are going to include no more than 6.5 grams of total fat. For saturated fat, the food item must have 1 gram or less saturated fat. And 15% or fewer calories must come from saturated fat. As far as trans fat goes, it must have less than 0.5 grams per serving. And also of note, products containing partially hydrogenated oils are not eligible for this heart check certification. And cholesterol must be 20 milligrams or less. Sodium, this depends on the food category, actually, and the requirements range from no more than 140 milligrams to no more than 480 milligrams per serving, depending on the food category. I do have a link that identifies these categories and the milligrams that this food category must stay within to receive the heart check. If you're interested, feel free to send us an email at Zakim. I would be happy to provide that. Additionally, 10% or more of the daily value of one of six nutrients must be present. And this could be vitamin A, vitamin C, iron, calcium, protein, or dietary fiber. So this food must contain at least 10% of one of these nutrients. And for category-specific requirements, you're welcome to visit the American Heart Association's website, heart.org. You'll also be able to find the sodium categories as well and requirements for each food category on their website, which is linked here. I wanted to also mention some healthy recipe libraries that you may be interested in reviewing for some inspiration. One is the Eating Well recipe library for heart healthy recipes. And what I love about this recipe library is that Eating Well chose recipes that met the AHA Heart Check guidelines. The AHA also has a Heart Check certified recipe library on their website, which is also linked here. So, what now? Well, we want to take it one step at a time. If any of these recommendations resonated with you, I'd encourage you to try to build in that recommendation in a way that works for you. For more support with making healthy habits stick, I'd recommend reviewing our either recorded webinar on this topic or presentation, which are both linked here and also available on the MyZakim website. Lastly, I wanted to review our sources, and I want to thank you for watching this presentation today. If you ever have any questions, feel free to email us at Zakim. And again, thank you for joining us. For more tips and tricks, visit myzakim-dana, excuse me, -farber.org. And if you're interested in joining one of these live sessions, we meet the first Wednesday of the month at 1 p.m. and we have a different topic each month, and you're welcome to register for that on our MyZakim website. Thank you so much.